Good morning, everybody. Thank you all for coming to the DRI Development Research Institute Debates in Development. My name is Yao Nyarko. I'm a professor of economics, and I have the privilege of being the co-director of DRI with Bill Easterling. We're going to have a wonderful event today, a lot of interaction, conversations, etc. Before I begin, there are a few things, announcements I'd like to make. First of all, thank you, all of you, for coming. And I'd like to give a special thanks to our speakers, Abhijit Banerjee, Esther DeFlo, Stuart Papperin, Michael Clemens, there is Michael, Bernadette Wanjala, Andrew Rugesira, and Angus Deaton. Thank you for coming here. We thank the university, but I'm going to be doing more thanks about that in a second. We thank our funders, NYU, for its ongoing support. The John Templeton Foundation, Thomas Smith Foundation, Earhart Foundation, and Seal Foundation, Freedom Foundation. Thanks to all our DRI staff. It took a lot of time and effort putting all this together. David Rice, Laura, and the entire team, okay? So thank you all for that. Student workers as well, Narine, Tanya, John, Lauren, Shaolei, Danielle, Simani, Arisa. There are actually two Danielles, so both of you get your thanks as well, okay? And the caterers. All right, so thank you. Some announcements. Please turn off your cell phones. I've turned mine off, okay? Announcement number one. Announcement number two. If you are tweeting, use hash DRI debates. And if you don't know what that means, come join the crowd. We are pleased to offer breakfast, lunch, and coffee throughout the day, but Cooper Union has asked us to emphasize no food in this room, the Great Hall, okay? I think they want to keep it clean, and I think this is a famous hall. Was it Abraham Lincoln gave a very important speech in here? So maybe in Abe Lincoln's honor, we will not eat here. All right, so next, I'd like to introduce the NYU Provost. He's a professor of mathematics and neuroscience in the Courant Institute. He's a member of the National Academy of Sciences. He was director of our Courant Institute from 1994 to 2002 before becoming NYU's provost. He works in theoretical visual neuroscience with an emphasis on modeling primary visual cortex. So he does all the serious stuff. But what I like the most, he grew up in a small town called Woodbine with 1,300 people. All right, it almost feels like, you know, a small rural area in Africa. A college degree earned by an uncle was the only higher education in his immediate family. Again, many of the stories you hear in Africa, Asia, are similar. And the one I like the best is he was an avid athlete playing baseball, basketball, football, and track, but dropped his athletic activities in favor of a double major in physics and math. There you go. And then to crown it all off, I have to say I was also privileged to work for a while in the provost's office as an administrator. And he was my boss, and a wonderful man to work with, very, very sincere. And he's been extremely helpful with everything we do. He's the provost of New York University, which, as many of you know, is the chief academic officer. We sometimes say it's the academic conscience of the university, handles all academics university-wide. So please, give a big round of applause and welcome Professor David McLaughlin.
Well, good morning, everyone. As provost of New York University, it is my real pleasure to welcome you to this annual conference of NYU's Development Research Institute. And in particular, I am really pleased to welcome the students amongst you from NYU and other institutions throughout the city and the world, and especially those students who have taken time off from midterms in order to be here. The theme today is debates and development within a global context. NYU, through a number of venues and programs, fosters dialogues on topics of global concern. The Development Research Institute is one of the university's hubs for rigorous scholarly research on economic development around the world. Under the co-leadership of Yao Nyarko and William Esterly, the Institute carries out its research in the context of the university's broad network of global centers and study away sites. NYU has transitioned from being a university in and of the city to one that's in and of the world, and to one that's now a global network university. NYU has approximately a dozen academic sites in the great cities of the world. These sites form the nodes of our global network. But the characterizing feature of our global network is not those nodes, but is the linkages and the interconnections between them. The nodes themselves are of several categories. We have our academic sites, which are sites for undergraduate students to study away for a semester, and for faculty and graduate students to do targeted research. These are located in many of the great cities of the world. We also have branch campuses of our schools giving degrees. We have three such, Tisch Asia, the law school program in Asia, and a business school program in London and Paris. These three programs give focused master's degrees in the areas of their study. And then we have in addition to New York City, two degree-granting comprehensive campuses, one in Abu Dhabi and one in Shanghai. Together, this constitutes our growing global network. And throughout that network, NYU students and faculties travel and interact as one interlinked network. Today, 50% of NYU's undergraduates spend a semester at one of our sites, and NYU attracts the third largest number of international students to study here in New York, third largest amongst all universities in the United States. So NYU truly is and is becoming the global network university. The Development Research Institute participates in that global network, having major programs at NYU Accra and NYU Abu Dhabi. And I'm sure we'll soon have major programs at other sites in the network. The Development Research Institute also is very interdisciplinary, inter-school in its activities here in New York, bringing together many parts of the university to do work in developmental economics. Some of these entities that the Institute brings together are Africa House, the Global Public Health Program, the New Center for Urban Science and Progress, urban engineering if you like, and my own institute, the Quran Institute of Mathematical Sciences, bringing together these entities to find and promote solutions to some of the most difficult challenges facing the world today. None of these activities would be of any importance if they didn't foster and enable strong faculty to do their important research. And that is the real goal of this structure, is to enable our faculty to do their research work. Once again, I thank you for coming to this conference. I'm sure it'll be a very good day and I welcome you to the conference and to New York University.
So once again, we thank Dave for his support and New York University for all it provides DRI. It's a little bit of introduction. What I'm going to do is tell you a little bit about what some of our team, what we're doing in the field. Over the course of today, you're going to be hearing a lot of the intellectual debates, the arguments, how to evaluate what's good, what's bad. Some of you, at the end of it, may feel very, very depressed. So now what are we supposed to do, okay? Some of you will feel that everything you've been doing has been a mistake. Because here they are, you know, your life's ambition, somebody's just ripping it all to pieces, okay? So I'm gonna encourage you not to have that view. I'm going to come up right now, I'm going to tell you that many of the things that are going to be criticized today, I am doing them, okay? And despite those criticisms, sometimes we have to keep plowing along, okay? So I'm just, by way of introducing what DRI is doing, what one of our centers, this team is doing, I'm going to be telling you a few things to set the context so that as we go through the theoretical debates, as we go through the pluses and minuses of different evaluation techniques, we should keep everything grounded in the reality of what's out there. Okay, so that's the purpose. Okay, let's see if I can work this thing. I think it goes this way. Perfect. All right, so Akwaba, that's Ashanti for a welcome. Thanks for coming here. So let me begin the conversation by asking, I'm a faculty member here, I'm an academic. What the heck are we trying to do anyway? What is the goal? Why do we do all the things we do? So motive number one, as an economist, we all work by incentives, and I get paid by the number of papers I write. At the end of every year, my department has what is called a merit and evaluation committee meeting, and they determine my salary. So I better publish. So a lot of what I do is, frankly, to publish papers. But there are different kinds of papers you can write, and I think all of us want to do good. So a lot of what I do as well, based in Africa, is because I care. I want to do something good. As scientists, sometimes we just want to figure out what the heck is going on. So I go to Africa sometimes, I hear all the stereotypes about Africa, and I just want to know, why does this work, or why does this fail, okay? So those are sort of the reasons why we do what we do, okay? So this is just setting it in context. I'm going to tell you some of the projects we have at a Center for Technology and Economic Development. So this is where, as the provost said, different faculty members across the university team up to solve problems. Here are some of the people in our team. So it's the Center for Technology and Economic Development. You can Google it. I won't, in the interest of time, go through all the names, but we have faculty, we have graduate students. We deal in a number of different areas, food and water, financial access, energy, healthcare, and education. I'll be giving you examples of them. And a big premise is based on this picture, okay? And so, of course, this is the Maasai, and I think I said this last year during this talk, the stereotype is you go into, you know, the fields, the Maasai, they live sometimes out in the bush, you see animals, lions walking around, and the cell phone rings and they pick it up, okay? And all right. So question number one we ask is all about food, food markets. One of the big issues in Africa, of course, is that agricultural productivity is very, very low. Is there anything we as economists, we as scientists, we as engineers or computer scientists can do about it? That's the question. A lot of excitement came from Richard Jensen's paper, which just showed that fishermen in Kerala, if you give them a cell phone, they can call ahead and figure out where on the coast to send their fish. So this is sort of the stereotype, if you will, the leading paper, the most quoted paper, which showed promise. What our team have been doing is to partner with a technology firm in Ghana. They're headquartered in Ghana, but it's an African, Africa-wide technology firm, ESOC. And what do? They deal with cell phones. They send text messages into the field. They have people in markets who collect prices, and they beam those prices on a cell phone to farmers all over. So the premise is that even though an area may be poor, even though you have a village with no electricity, they still may have access to mobile coverage. So somebody takes the phone, goes to the next village, charges it, come back. So you can put data on it. So that's part of what we're doing. And at this stage, I should thank Stuart on behalf of Isoko, because Stuart and Soros is a big funder. And thanks to an anonymous donor, who may or may not be in this room right now, who funded work that we have done with Isoko on this. So this is a part of our project. So again, I'm coming up out in public saying, I have done a randomized controlled trial, okay? Guilty as charged. All right, so in the Volta region, the northern part of the Volta region, we've done an RCT, 98 communities, about 10 farmers in each community. What the heck are we trying to do? Isoko sends out price information to farmers all across that region. We want to figure out what do they do with it. Do they bargain better with traders who are coming in? Do they change the kinds of activities that they do? Do they sell their crops in a different market? What do they do with this information? And can that be a vehicle for improving their livelihoods? Okay, so that's the question. You ask them in surveys, do they know prices elsewhere? They don't. So in principle, this should be something which is very, very valuable, okay? So anyway, that's the RCT that we do. And this is at the bottom there is a picture of a market. And the goal, of course, is A, figure out what's going on, B, do some good, and heck, for me, write some papers so that at the end of the year I can get a raise. All right, some of the issues we found out in the villages, okay? So this phone here is an iPhone. It's kind of cool. You turn it on, you can see where to text, everything makes sense, okay? If you ever go and get one of these cheap phones, okay, they're small, you can barely put your fingers on them, it's next to impossible for me to figure out how to text on those things, okay? Our farmers, we are finding out, are having great difficulty figuring out how to text. And so one of the things that we're doing in the field, educating farmers on how to text. Okay, for you guys, it may seem as if it's an easy thing, but just imagine giving your grandmother this and seeing if she's going to be able to figure it out. So anyway, those are some of the issues going on. I'm seeing the time moving forward. Another area that we're interested in is weather. Okay, so farmers complain that they wish they knew when it would rain so that either the decide when not to put the fertilizer on because the rain is going to wash it away, okay? Or when to harvest, okay? So this is very, very important to them. So we're working with Isoko to, A, figure out how useful is this? What do they do with the information, okay? The goal, ultimately, is to see whether we can introduce some kind of insurance schemes for them, right? So that if there's a poor harvest, just like most of you have car insurance, the farmers too can have some kind of insurance. Okay, so that's the ultimate goal. Once you have weather forecasting, you can deal with rainfall insurance. There are a whole bunch of issues associated with that. One of the findings in the field is that try as hard as you will to introduce these schemes, there's no uptake. For some reason or the other, the farmers are not, they're not buying the insurance. Okay, so one of the intellectual questions we have right now that we're pondering over is how to get them to actually like this. Could it be that the kind of insurance they're being given isn't correlated enough with their losses? So when they get a loss, the rainfall insurance says, oh, it was a good day. Could it just be that they don't trust the insurance companies? Okay, so these are all issues that we're working with. Then we go into the trader side. We just spoke about farmers, okay? And so in the cities, you see a lot of bustling African markets. They sound great. They look great. But when you go into the villages, sometimes they're very, very poor. And it will break your heart to see some of the farmers walking literally 10 miles with a tiny piece of food on their heads to go to the local regional market. Okay? So again, can we use cell phones and eBay kind of system to help the farmers out? That's the intellectual problem that we're trying to solve here. Some pictures of markets. Let me just skip that for now. So that's on the small scale. On the bigger scale, Ethiopia recently, maybe 4 or 5 years ago, introduced a commodities exchange almost from scratch, okay? And so this is as organized as you can imagine. It looks like a small African version of the Chicago Board of Trade. Are there insights we can get from that and apply to the rural areas? Okay, so again, that's another area of study that we have right now. I'm just gonna skip through it. And this is a picture of Ethiopia. A woman trying to force the donkey to carry, I think this is oil, sesame oil, from the production area to where it's being sold. Can you transform that to a highly modern commodities exchange? And if you go and see the ECX offices, it is actually fairly impressive what they've been able to do in about 4 or 5 years. So again, the big question is this something which is replicable? Is this a solution to the problems of African farmers? Unfortunately, apart from the example of Ethiopia, in most of sub-Saharan Africa, excluding South Africa, same issue, no uptake. It's been impossible to introduce these. And so part of our researchers, that's what they're working on. Okay, so that gives you a little bit of a feel for what we're doing. Let me just tell you a few things we're doing on the technology side. So this is called a contextual information portal. These are computer science students and faculty have developed the following. In many poor countries, internet access is spotty, intermittent. Electricity itself is intermittent. You want students to be able to study, say, physics. How do you do it? Well, wouldn't it be great if you have a system where anytime the light goes on and the internet is working on this hard drive, you can just update information on only physics so that it's always current? In areas which have absolutely no internet access, can you download all of physics from the web with all the links so that at least for physics on that hard drive, students in a remote area will have access to the web? Okay? So that's the technology that some of our computer science folks have developed, and it's now done. And unlike economists, computer scientists, when they finish their project, they actually go out and have a startup. So they're beginning a startup on this. Other research that's being done, can we use social media and the web in particular to predict climate issues, famines, etc.? And so the idea is you crawl the web, you fix a location, and you see whether there's a spike in articles about, for example, famine, okay? And you keep doing that. And so it's usually like this, and all of a sudden it spikes up, okay? So that's a test for whether there's famine in that area based primarily on social media, okay? So anyway, that's another thing that they're doing. Satellite imagery, you continuously look at the world and figure out when agricultural land is going to waste, urbanization or some other reason, traffic. And I think last year I spoke about Africa, the dark continent, being dark with respect to light. Big solar schemes, small solar schemes. And another group, they used to be with us last year. They have this new technology where you take a solar panel, you put a SIM card in it. Again, based on the philosophy that GSM, solar activities, telephony exists everywhere, including in the villages. And so you can use that. The fact that everywhere you go, you have cell phone access, you put a SIM card, the same one that's in mine, inside the panel itself. The panel will be sending text messages to the center, so the center can record the health of the panel, okay? One of the big issues with solar is that it takes too much time and effort to go from the city into the remote area just to fix one or two panels, and that's a huge part of the cost. And so this team wanted to get around that with this. Okay, so I think they've made quite a bit of progress, and they too have left our team and have a startup. Okay? So I'm going to end here. The goal was just to give you a flavor of some of the real-world things that we're doing, a flavor of some of the issues that come up, and just to tell you that we're all trying hard. The goal, my goal, is the betterment of poor people. And so as you're listening through the debates today, take heart. Don't get depressed. When people are accusing each other of something, just say, well, Yao did that too, okay? And stay cheerful. So thank you again all for coming. And I know we're going to have a wonderful set of debates. Thank you.
Okay, so you have heard from the cheerful guy now. Now you hear from the opposite. One thing that's changed since last year is I've broken up with PowerPoint. The relationship just wasn't working for me anymore. I felt like, you know, PowerPoint and I had just kind of gotten stale. She's really still doing a wonderful job for Yao, but I just got burnt out. I had to move on. And she wasn't that happy with me either. She said I kept producing slides that were too gloomy. So, no PowerPoint. What I want to talk about is, as sort of a way of introducing the rest of the program, is the role of explicit scientific knowledge in development. Because we're going to be talking today about several different projects that use explicit scientific knowledge, like the Millennium Villages using a lot of scientific experts to figure out how to do the agriculture right, how to do the water right, et cetera. We're going to be talking about randomized controlled trials, which are a very rigorous form of producing solid scientific knowledge. And I just want to put that kind of knowledge in context. That kind of knowledge is not the only kind of knowledge we use in development. We also use other kinds of less formal knowledge. So the title of my talk is Smart Scientific Solutions versus Dumb Solution-Finding Systems. Did you get that? Smart scientific solutions versus dumb solution-finding systems. It's a mouthful, but it's kind of alliterates, so I hope it's okay. And to keep up the alliteration, I mean, I have talked about three aspects of knowledge: cost, context, and consternation. Cost, context, and consternation. So what about cost? Now, I don't want to suggest a cost-benefit analysis of research. Research we do for its own sake. We don't worry about the cost of the research. We just do the research. But if we're going to use knowledge in an applied way in development and aid, then we do need to think about cost. And one of the most notable things that you can say about expert scientific knowledge is it's extremely expensive. You know, it takes years and years to produce a PhD, then it takes years and years to produce a tenured professor, and then it takes years and years to produce a world-class expert that works at the Earth Institute at Columbia. So, you know, this is expensive stuff. Now, what is one of the most fundamental principles in economics? You produce things that economize on the scarce, expensive resources, and that try to use the cheap, abundant resources. Okay, so we make Kleenex using paper, because paper is cheap and abundant, and we don't have too many products that I'm aware of sort of gold laminated Kleenex. If anybody's aware of gold laminated Kleenex, please let me know. If you really are not getting this intuition, it's because, you know, the gold is scarce and expensive, you would not use it to make Kleenex. Am I getting the point across here? I have taught principles before, so I can do this, I think. So let's apply this to Millennium Villages. Millennium Villages seem to be using, now again, I don't want to, you know, prejudge the debate that's going to go on here, so I'm trying to hide my own prejudices very unsuccessfully. Millennium Villages They use a lot of world-class scientists that are extremely scarce and expensive a resource. So I'm kind of wondering if one kind of serious question we might be asking about Millennium Villages is, can you really scale up something that is intensively using a scarce, expensive resource? Can you really scale it up to, you know, 700 million people continent-wide in Africa? I just put that out as a question for you. No bias implied. What about randomized controlled trials? You know, again, they're great as research. They're a rigorous way to get to establish what causes what, to identify the treatment effect in research. That's great. But if you are going to have an entire aid system that is guided by randomized controlled trials, if you're going to make a strong assertion that you are only going to choose aid projects and determine aid strategy only on the basis of randomized controlled trials and nothing else, that sounds to me like you're proposing an aid strategy that's very intensive in the use of a very expensive, scarce resource, which is, you know, the randomized controlled trials cost a ton of money to do. And they are done by these expert, wonderful, you know, MIT and Harvard professors that we all admire and venerate, but they're, you know, I'm sorry, they're scarce. There's only so many Esther Duflos to go around. So you cannot run the whole aid program based on Esther Duflos. And so that's my very elementary principles insight into the case against, you know, you don't want to base everything on this kind of smart scientific solutions as opposed to dumb solution-finding systems. Now, what do I mean by dumb solution-finding systems? Again, still talking about cost. There are much cheaper ways to find solutions than, you know, so explicit knowledge, scientific knowledge, not the only way to find solutions. There are cheaper ways to find solutions. So, for example, just to give you a very home, kind of home-based idea, so when I go see my doctor, I'm very grateful that the doctor is prescribing medicine for me, you know, for my stomach condition. He's prescribing Nexium, which is, you know, this has been rigorously established to work by randomized controlled trials. So I'm not saying they have no place. That's great. I'm glad that he's basing that on rigorous scientific knowledge. But then how did I find my doctor? I didn't set up randomized controlled trials among all the doctors in New York to find the best doctor. I didn't find, you know, we use more informal, you know, we ask around, we ask for recommendations. So, you know, I didn't choose my doctor because of a randomized controlled trial. I chose him because he's Joe Stiglitz's cousin. That was good enough for me. Joe Stiglitz's cousin. That's my doctor. Now, of course, the more serious example of this, of a dumb solution-finding system, is entrepreneurs. Entrepreneurs produce things, and they try out a ton of things, and they just do things by trial and error, and they have a dumb solution-finding system, which is they just see what the customers are buying. And so they stop producing the things the customers are not buying, and they produce more of what the customers are buying. So, you know, we're going to hear later in the afternoon, right after lunch, from a great African entrepreneur from Uganda who's pioneered Uganda's surprising entry into the world gourmet coffee market. And now, just to show you that there is no gag so cheesy that I will not go for, I actually got him to bring some of his coffee, and I made a cup of coffee. And if those of you who know me, you know one of my gigantic passions is coffee. I love coffee. So I actually did the taste test for the first time, and I love this coffee. So, you know, let me just take a sip. This is wonderful coffee. So, you know, this entrepreneur using this dumb solution finding. Now, I'm not saying the entrepreneurs are dumb. I don't want to don't want to insult my wonderful colleague, Andrew Rugasira here, who we're going to hear from later. No, the entrepreneurs, they're smart enough to use a dumb solution finding system. They know that it would be too expensive to do a randomized controlled trial among all the every consumer to see whether the consumers, you know, blood pressure and and alertness go up by an established quantifiable treatment effect as a result of their coffee. They use something cheaper and simpler. You trial and error, you see what the customers like, and boom, you find the answer. So, you know, what does that mean for development? It seems like, you know, the model for development interventions, sure, they are going to use smart scientific solutions some of the time, but it seems like the entrepreneurship model is a better model for a lot of other situations in development. And what would that mean? It would mean that we try to replicate the sort of customer feedback situation that entrepreneurs benefit from, which is this dumb solution-finding system. And I'm still amazed, even after years in this field, how little effort anybody in aid and development ever exerts to try to give a voice and some choice to the beneficiaries of a development program. Voice and choice, that's a dumb solution-finding system to give beneficiaries the ability to give feedback on, you know, what are the solutions that are working. That's a dumb solution-finding system that has not been used anywhere near enough. It's hardly used at all in development. And instead, we're producing gold-laminated Kleenex. So that's my biases were really, really hidden very well there. But okay, next context. So I'm going to speed up now because I don't have much time to learn. So next context. So you can make a case for smart scientific solutions if what they produce is this global public good called perfect knowledge. Perfect knowledge that is infinitely available at zero cost to everyone involved. If they produce, so what this boils down to is the knowledge produced in the Millennium Village, is it generalizable to all the other villages in Africa? Is a randomized controlled trial that finds a treatment effect of one intervention, does that apply to that intervention and in all other contexts as well? If it does, then all my arguments about cost kind of go out the window. I lose all the arguments that I was just making about, you know, smart scientists are too expensive. They're not expensive if you can share the benefits of their knowledge across a vast population. So that's really the key question that the use of smart scientists really boils down to. Is the knowledge they produce, is it a pure public good that can be shared, you know, scaled up enormously or not? And that really depends on context. Now, unfortunately, for the case for smart scientists, like Tip O'Neill would say, all knowledge is local. You know, knowledge solutions really do depend on context. You know, so whether textbooks written in English work really does depend on whether the students know English and other little, you know, details like that. So context matters. And so that starts to limit the amount of generalizability of these smart scientific solutions. And what's more, to make it even worse, context keeps changing. So that means that you have, you know, even if you figure out the right response to the context, you know, tomorrow the context will be different. So again, that would suggest that if that's the case, then again, you want to find a dumb solution-finding system that can keep doing the 1,001 adaptations of scientific knowledge to local conditions and keep changing as it changes, again, using some system that's based on choice and voice for the beneficiaries. So, you know, how do we see this in entrepreneurship? I'll just advertise a little bit of research that we're doing at DRI that I actually mentioned last year also. That's another element of how costly it is to produce knowledge, is that papers in academia take forever to produce. I'm just issuing the first draft of a paper I've been working on for 8 years with a co-author, but that's another paper. So we started this project last year, and we're still advancing. We still don't have a first draft, but we're studying, or we sort of got the insight that there's too much development analysis going on that's obsessed with the unit of the nation state. And that makes things look more predictable and knowable than they really are. Because, you know, like say the US economy has been growing at 2% per capita for the last 200 years. It looks like a very stable thing. So we got the idea, let's look at the complete opposite extreme. We took one block in Manhattan and we studied 400 years of history on that one block. And we saw the enormous chaos of creative destruction on that one block. So, the different things that happen on this block over time through the entrepreneurship again, through the ability of firms and workers and entrepreneurs and trade and finance to freely move in and out of this block as conditions shifted. This block started out its history as a farm that was actually unusually owned by slaves, by African slaves, were owned the land and produced agricultural produce for New York City on this block. A century or so later, it became known as the center of the brothel industry in New York. I won't go into a lot of detail about that era, unless you want me to. And then right after that, it became ground zero of the industrial boom in the United States. It was an enormously successful manufacturing block. Then it declined, and then it came back again, and today it's called Soho. It's a block of Green Street in Soho where there's a Ralph Lauren and there's the Apple Store. And so, you know, creative destruction at the local level gives us an idea of how much we need the dumb solution finding systems. Now, the last part, consternation. I worked really hard I was trying to use the word surprise, but I was trying to get the cost, context, consternation to alliterate. So I kind of overreached here to find this awkward word. Consternation. So the point is just that because context matters so much, success and failure are often a surprise. And that's the other thing that lowers the return to the expert scientific knowledge, the smart scientific solutions. That when you actually apply things on the ground, whether it works or not is often a surprise. So to give one example that Esther and Abhijit are very honest about in their book, Poor Economics, and that's one thing I loved about the book, is they're incredibly honest about all the positives and negatives of their research. So they found, that they have this great result that they have a great system for making sure that teachers show up for class. And so they had a dramatic effect on improving teachers showing up in class in India. Then they tried another program to make sure the nurses show up at health clinics, very similar ideas and strategy, and that was a total failure. In fact, they even say that it made things worse, that their attempt to solve that system, all that it did was it let the nurses know how little their bosses cared about whether they showed up or not. And so they actually started showing up less after Esther and Abhijit's project. I love them for their honesty for admitting that they get a million points of credit for that. So that's the consternation that things that you think are going to work. This is basically the whole difference between sort of the planners and the searchers or entrepreneurs. The planners think that they have perfect knowledge, and the entrepreneurs and searchers think that everything is more like a surprise. So that's kind of the polar divide. So let me close with an example that, and you know, the success of Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi, and coffee, again, a total surprise found by the dumb solution-finding system of entrepreneurs. Now, well, let me close with another cheesy gimmick that I'm going to play on you. So there's only one thing that, one other hobby that I'm passionate about as coffee, and that's classical music. So I'm going to try an experiment on you by a musical entrepreneur. So, composers are musical entrepreneurs. They try to create things that will make it into the repertoire that, the symphonies will play. And a lot of times they're unsuccessful, and sometimes they're successful. So I'm going to play three movements, just very brief excerpts from three movements of a string quartet. And I want to test out on you how successful this string quartet is just by whether you recognize it or not. So I'll start playing this music, and if you recognize it, then raise your hand, okay? If you don't recognize it, then just remain silent and say, what the heck is he doing? Okay, so here's the first movement that I'm going to try out on you. Just raise your hand if you recognize this. Okay, that movement does, so far the string quartet does not seem to be a great success. Nobody in the room recognized it. Another possible explanation is that somehow DRI attracts musical illiterates to our conferences. Okay, let me give you another chance. I'm going to play another movement. Are you having fun now? Okay. I'm going to play another movement. This is another chance for you. Okay, we struck out again. So those are two out of the three movements of the string quartet. Oh, you recognize it. Okay, let me talk to you afterwards about music. Okay, so now I'm going to play the last movement. This poor composer, he worked, you know, his whole career to produce music that would make it into the repertoire that you would recognize, and so far it's been a complete bust on this string quartet. Looks like one of the most unsuccessful string quartets of all time. I'm really sorry about this. So now let me play the third movement of this same string quartet by the same composer. I think we're getting some recognition now. This is Barber's Adagio for Strings, one of my favorite pieces of music, I'm kind of sorry that it's so gloomy. We don't have time to get all the way to the end. The ending is actually pretty uplifting if we get to the end. So let me leave this with you as a kind of inspirational idea of entrepreneurship. Here's a guy who, this is the only piece that he ever produced that ever made it into the repertoire. And they wouldn't even take the whole string quartet. They dropped those other two movements and said, you know, we don't want to listen to those. We're only going to take this movement. But still, you know, to work your whole career and only produce one thing, that sounds sad. That sounds like the gloomy things that you associate DRI with. But on the other hand, you know, and we always want to celebrate the great development leaders, the planners as the heroes. And I'd rather celebrate the entrepreneurs, the artists, the creators as the heroes. So what it means to me to hear this piece is that, you know, here you got this guy who worked so hard his whole career, and he did succeed, that at some moment he broke through and he reached some level of inspiration and kind of artistic vision. It's just an amazing inspiration for what entrepreneurs can achieve when they do succeed. And I think that is a hopeful image for these dumb solution-finding systems that are based on endless trial and error by endless entrepreneurs, that eventually, as you keep trying, eventually reach something of great beauty, great value, that the customers appreciate, that makes the lives of everyone in development better. That's what we have to hope for from our dumb solution-finding systems. So I will leave you with that thought. Thank you very much.